Last Sunday, we turned to Matthew chapter 9. We looked at the story of Jesus being moved by compassion. As we mentioned earlier in verse 4, he knew their thoughts. And then later in the chapter, down in verse 36, it says that he looked at the multitude and the condition of people's lives moved him to compassion. It moved him. Compassion, there in the Greek, meaning to yearn, to bow over, to feel, to have empathy for people. He was moved. Jesus looked at the multitude. That word multitude just kept ringing in my head, multitude. It's like the people had reached a tipping point. They reached a point of saturation, and it caused God to move. And we've looked at our nation. We've looked at our churches in America, and I just feel that God is once again on the move. He's been moved by compassion. People have reached a tipping point. We look at the nation and we really believe that God is taking us through a reformation. But if that reformation is going to be sustained, then the church must reform itself or reshape itself. Reform. We looked at Jeremiah 7 and 3, where the Lord said to Israel, reform your ways, and I will let you live in this place. If we're going to step into the future, if we're going to be a part of what God's getting ready to do, then the church has to reform in order to abide in that place where God is taking us. If God is doing a reformation in America, I want to be a part of it. How about you? So I have to reform. So we looked at reform as an acrostic, and we tried to pull out, extract some truths that would help you and I to go through this reform. R stood for reposition. We talked about the men in the New Testament riding as they were moved by Holy Spirit. And we talked about flowing with Holy Spirit, flowing with him, and letting him reposition you in the coming days. And we made this statement, get in where you fit in. Get in where you fit. Don't just get in anywheres, but get in where you fit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Apostle Paul said that Holy Spirit places the parts of the body in each place where he wants them to be. How many knows that you are at your best when you're where you're supposed to be? Amen? So get in where you fit in, not just in any place. So reposition yourself in 2017. Figure out what your strengths are, your giftings, and your calling, and get in where you fit in. E stands for exhale. We made the statement, God sent you here today to catch your second wind. God is getting ready to exhale. In the New Testament, it's called pneuma. He did it in Acts chapter 2 when he breathed into the nostrils of that church and became a living organism. In the Old Testament, it's called Ruach HaKodesh, holy breath, when he breathed into Adam and he stood up a living soul. And I just believe that God's getting ready to exhale again. As he did with the multitude in Matthew chapter 9, he saw the multitude. He saw that they were saturated and reached a tipping point. And he exhaled. He was moved with compassion. I think God's getting ready to exhale, and the church is going to stand up and catch its second wind. Amen? F stood for facelift, and a lot of you ladies really enjoyed this one, that God's getting ready to give a facelift. Not that you need one, but that you just, the idea of a free facelift. So F stood for facelift. In 2017, I'm claiming Psalms 3:3, your glory is the lifter of my head. If you're down and depressed, if you're oppressed, if you're beat down, then get under the glory and let God lift your countenance. Let God lift your face. You need a facelift in 2017. Amen? O stood for oppose. When you find yourself in a tight place, listen to the voice of patience. Balaam was in a tight place, and that donkey he was on, that word means patience. Patience was trying to warn him, you need to slow down. And I made this statement, not all opposition is from the devil. So quit opposing Holy Spirit. If you're in a tight place, maybe it's not the devil, maybe it's God trying to slow you down. So listen to patience. Amen? She's sitting right next to you. Listen. Not that she's a donkey, but listen to patience. Listen to your spouse. Amen? R stood for rear guard. A runaway slave is someone who can't escape his or her past. You got to quit running from your past. It's time to drown your Pharaoh. 2017, let's drown Pharaoh. Let's quit running from Pharaoh. Amen? Because a runaway slave is just someone who can't get away from their past. And it's time the Christians quit being runaway slaves and just always running from something. It's time to draw a line in the sand, stand our ground, and drown Pharaoh and be done with it. Amen? Last one, M stood for move. It's time to stir things up. Move. M stood for move. Stir things up. Stir things up. It's time to stir things up. Paul talked about it. Stir up the gifting that's within. It's time for you to get stirred up. It's time for you to get back your passion, your first love, your excitement, your intensity. It's time to stir things up. As chocolate settles to the bottom of the milk, you need to stir it up. You've lost your chocolate. You need to get it back up to the surface. You need to stir things up. Luke chapter 9. This morning in verse 62 is where we're going to turn. And this will be our text for today. The Bible says, but Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit. Say fit. Fit. Is fit for the kingdom of God. Now, most of us, when we read that scripture, we believe that it's speaking to qualification. If you're looking back, you're not qualified. Now, I'm not going to say that's not true. That's applicable. But let me give you the meaning of that word in the Greek. The word fit there means well placed. So let's read it again. But Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is well placed in the kingdom of God. You see, if you're always looking back, you're going to miss your placement. If you're always looking back, you're going to miss your divine appointment. So look beyond just saying, well, if you're looking back, you're half-hearted, you're not qualified, you're not committed, you're not dedicated. And perhaps that's true. But looking back will also cause you to miss your God moment and your divine appointments. Your backward look can cause you to miss your kingdom placement. Today, God's on the Move, part two. Pray with me. Father, we thank you for your anointing, your presence that we've already experienced here this morning. So let the rhema word of the Lord come forth. Father, let me deliver a message. I do not want to preach a sermon. Help me to deliver a message. So Holy Spirit, come. Spirit of prophecy, rest on me. Help me today. Make me a wordsmith. Bring revelation into the room because I sense you're on the move. There's a reformation coming. Restoration is coming. So the church must reform, reshape itself, and get ready. Help Cathedral, Father. Help us to be ready for what's on the horizon. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, that's me. Amen, amen. Let me talk to you for just a minute about right time, right place. Right person. Think about it. There's something special about the right time, the right place, and the right person. Wow. Preparation meeting opportunity equals success. We understand that. There's something very special. about getting in the right place. Now remember, we're talking about God's on the move. We're talking about a reformation. We're talking about me reforming myself, reshaping myself. We're talking about putting my hand to the plow and not looking backwards and thus missing my divine placement. Today we're talking about placement. We're talking about fitting in, getting in where you fit in, making sure that I'm operating in my calling, in my anointing, in my giftings, in my talent. We're talking about placement, okay? Right time, right place, right person. Number one, never underestimate the power of place. Never do that. Never do that. That's why we talk a lot here about the spirit of prophecy, about kairos moments. Remember, chronological time is the clock, but a kairos moment is a divine appointment. It's when God interrupts, time stands still, and God starts moving. This morning during worship, I felt a kairos moment. That's when miracles can happen, if you step through that window or that door. So we understand the power of placement, stepping into a moment. There is a power connection whenever the right person meets the right place. One example, we're not going to linger here, but it's Joseph. Do you see what happened to Joseph with all that he went through? Sold into slavery by his brothers, put into prison, treated the way he was, lied upon by Potiphar's wife, all that took place. And yet all of that led him up to that divine placement where he was in Egypt, the right time, at the right place, and the right person. And look how much good that man did for the kingdom of God. We're still talking today. Being in the right place at the right time. Whenever you plug in, there's a power connection. It's like taking and plugging into a wall outlet. Whenever you plug in, there's a power surge. There's a power connection. There is something special about seeing a man or a woman step into their place, step into their moment. It's powerful to see that. That's why I love the arts so much. I love to see people do what they do the way they do it. There's something so creative about it, whether it's in sports or whether it's in the arts and the media, wherever it is, when people lead worship, when they play an instrument, when they sing, when they dance, when they act, the things they do, there's something so special about seeing someone at the right time, in the right place, the right person. It's powerful to see that. But just as powerful as that is, think how dysfunctional it is when you've got the wrong person in the wrong place. Amen? Something powerful about place. So you see, we know that when you do what you do the way you do it, you are dangerous. Yeah, when you do what you do the way you do it, you're dangerous. As David would not wear the armor of Saul, but he picked up a little leather rag and five stones and he went out and he did what he did the way he did it. He was dangerous. Knocked that boy down and took his own sword and cut his head off. Give a person a rag and a rock and watch them do their thing. Ain't that awesome? I get so excited when I see young people through fine arts get on a platform and you can just see it. You can just, it's the kiss is on them. The anointing, the gifting is there. You just see it. Public speaking or acting or dancing or singing or playing an instrument. There's something about that that's just amazing to me, to watch the gifting that comes down from heaven to get inside of a person and watch them do their thing. They're dangerous. Never underestimate you getting in the right place at the right time. Number two, a good plan for a great place demands the right person, though. A good plan for a great place takes the right person. A runaway slave cannot possess a free man's promises. Let me say that again. A runaway slave out of Egypt will never possess a free man's promises. We've spoken this many times. God got Israel out of Egypt. He just couldn't get Egypt out of Israel. So when they come to Kadesh Barnea, 12 spies, survey the land, come back. 10 said, we can't do it. We can't do it. We can't do it. Why? Because they were still runaway slaves. They just couldn't get free of that thing. And so God had to work it out of them. He had to work it out of them. So you get on the treadmill for 40 years and you just working it out, working it out, working it out. A slave, a runaway slave, can never possess a free man's promises. That's why I'm saying drown your Pharaoh. Get Egypt out of your mind. Free yourself from your past. Let's step into our promises. Let's possess our land. Let's take 2017. Let's do great things for the kingdom of God. I declare in this room freedom this morning. Are you with me today? How many want some freedom? Freedom. Freedom. You see, the 10 spies came back and said, we can't do this. We seemed like grasshoppers in their eyes. A grasshopper mindset will never possess a giant-sized promise. Oh, guys. So if you don't tweet that one. A grasshopper mindset will never possess a giant-sized promise. I want some giant-sized stuff. Come on. I want some big stuff. I want some big stuff. I want to take some cities that are walled up and tall walls. I want the big grapes. Let's take some giant-sized promises. I don't want people just healed of a headache. I want to see arthritis go. I want to see cancer, tumors, crippled walls. I don't want to just, are you with me? I'm glad if God heals your headache. I'm just so thankful. But I want to see more than that, amen? We've got to have some stuff in here, guys. So we've got to understand a good plan and a great place takes the right person. You've got to step into your place. Number three, success is the result of getting in where you fit in. That's success, getting in where you fit in. Getting in where you fit in, or getting in where you're well placed. The good can become the enemy of the best. There's a lot of things that I have to do, guys, as a pastor that's good, but it's not the best. And I have to be careful with that I don't allocate my time just trying to just do the good. I've got to make sure I do the best, the best, the best. What you need from me more than anything is that I come out of the throne room with a rhema word for you every Sunday. More than anything, amen, that there's anointing in my hands to see things broken off of you, that I'm a man of integrity and righteousness, and I walk in the word of the Lord. Those are the things you need the most, amen, that I flow with the presence of God, that I'm anointed, the Holy Spirit's in my life, amen, that I'm listening to him and walking in the Spirit. There's a lot of other good stuff I need to do, but I got to be careful to keep priorities, amen, the best. And so is it with you. You've got to make sure that you keep your priorities, that you don't allow the good to become the enemy of the best. You've got to watch this. You've got to be well-placed, well-placed, well-placed. I am in my zone. How many wants to get in their zone? Get in your zone, man. Get in your zone. It's a sweet spot. It's like in basketball. You can tell when a guy's in the zone. He can't miss. It's like a quarterback. It's like a quarterback. He's in the zone. When you're in the zone, you can't miss. You're deadly. It's like surgically. He'll slice and dice you and cut you to pieces. In the zone. Well placed. And that's why you have to be careful with the persona. A facade. A fake you. Because a persona can kill a person. A persona can kill the person. If you're not in your zone, if you're not well placed, that persona can kill you. You got to be careful with that. Don't be something you're not. Here's a statement for you. Stop trying to be more than what you are and just be good at who you are. Stop trying to be more than what you are. Just be good at who you are. Yeah. If you're not a teacher, don't teach. If you can't sing, listen. In Corinthians, Paul says to be content in the station of life that you're in. Are you with me? Yeah. He said, be content. I wish I could sing. I really do. I love to worship. And if I could play that keyboard and sing like David. But when God was handing out gifts on that day, I didn't get in that line. And I can't sing. And my children and my grandchildren seem to let me. One of them the other day, one of the grandchildren, they did that thing to me again where it's kind of like quit, you know. So, look. I can either be resentful and envious of other people. You know what envy is? This is envy. Buster, you got my stuff and I want it back. Buster ain't got my stuff. He's got his own stuff. Envy says, you got some of my stuff. I want it. He's got his stuff. Go get your stuff. Quit being envious of other people. Listen, get your own stuff. Amen? And I need to be content with who God made me to be, because I need to get in the zone. I need to slip into that well-placed. Remember, my hand of the plow. I wish I could sing. I wish I could, you know, play an instrument. I wish I could be that person. I wish I could do that. If you're not well-placed, you're going to miss the kingdom. If you're always looking over your shoulder, regretting, wishing, envious, comparing, you're going to miss your divine appointment. Quit trying to be more than what you are and just be the best at who you are. Amen? We're talking about the power of place. Okay. Oh, Jesus. Let me talk to you for just a minute about the puzzle of life. We're talking about placement and just getting fit in, okay? Fitting in. The power of place. Remember, Corinthians 12 said, Holy Spirit decides which each member, you know, where they fit within the body, okay? Aren't you glad that God had enough sense to put your eye up here and not in the back of your head? But see, that's what we do as Christians. We're always comparing. Paul even said there that the hand says to the foot, I don't need you. Or, you know, and we're always saying, you're not important. But just think if it was left up to us to do placement, we'd have things all messed up, okay? And so you have to understand that Holy Spirit has decided where you're going to fit within the body, and he placed you there with all your giftings and your talent and your personality, your temperament, your individuality. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. This is who I am. So he places me. Okay. It's a puzzle. And I have to fit in. You got to get in where you fit in. The word fit in the Greek also means not only well-placed, but it means useful. How many agrees that you want to be useful? I want to count. How many wants their life to count for something? And so you've got to be useful, productive. So if you're going to be productive, you've got to get in where you fit in, or you're not going to complete the picture. A puzzle piece that doesn't fit is useless. You've got to get in where you fit in so you can be useful. Now, I want you to, let me read something to you. I've seen something here I've never seen before. In John chapter 3, verses 3 through 6, you know the scripture. It's Jesus talking to Nicodemus, born again. You remember the story, born again. But let me read it to you in a different translation. Jesus said, you're absolutely right. Take it from me, unless a person is born from above, it's not possible to see what I'm pointing to God's kingdom. How can anyone, said Nicodemus, be born who has already been born and grown up? You can't re-enter your mother's womb and be born again. What are you saying with this born from above talk? Verse 5, Jesus said, you're not listening. Let me say it again. Unless a person submits to this original creation, the wind hovering over the water creation. Interesting. The invisible moving the visible. A baptism into a new life. Unless you do that, it's not possible to enter God's kingdom. When you look at a baby, it's just that, a body you can look at and touch. But the person who takes shape within is formed by something you can't see and touch, the spirit, and it becomes a living spirit. Interesting. He talks about original creation. He talks about the invisible moving the visible. He talks about the man on the inside taking shape. Interesting. First thing he did is he said, you have to submit to the original you. The original you. Now, I don't want to lose you here, so I'm going to try my best to communicate to you what I feel in my spirit. But you have to submit to the original you unless a person submits to this original creation. You see, you have to be born again. Born again. You have to be born again to the original you. You've got to get back to the beginning. That's what it means to be born again, to go back to the beginning. The Bible says, Genesis 1, then God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. How many would agree that being born again is getting back to the original intention that God had for man, his original ideal? How many knows that God wanted Adam to walk in the cool of the day, to be clothed by his presence, to be his son, and nothing separate them, okay? But sin brought separation. But when we're born again, I'm getting back to the original creation. The Bible said it this way. Where the first Adam failed, the second Adam, Jesus, succeeded. So whenever I'm born again, I'm actually getting born again to the original creation, the original ideal that God had. I'm getting back to the original creation. Did you know that the word man in Genesis 1:26 means mankind? Mankind. Now, I want you to stay with me now. So he comes and he creates mankind. How many understands that in Adam represented what God intended for you and me? When he created Adam, you see the DNA, the genetics, the bloodline, you see, he sees mankind. He put within Adam the ability to procreate. And so you see that when he looks at Adam, he sees mankind. He sees you and me in that bloodline. He created mankind. And so whenever he says to me, as in Jeremiah 1, before I shaped you in the womb, I knew all about you. Before you saw the light of day, I had holy plans for you. A prophet to the nations, that's what I had in mind for you. Think about that. God had something in mind. When he looked at Adam, mankind, original creation, he looks through the generations and he had something in mind. He had a plan for mankind. He had a plan for me. Before I was shaped in my mother's womb, he had a plan for me. He had an ideal. The Bible said that this is in the mind of God. So you see, there's a revelation, a mental image of you that only God knows. Are you with me now? God's looking and he sees me from generations back. He has a mental image of me. This is what I see Randy as. This is what I'm going to create. This is what I'm going to do. God's got something in mind for me. There's an original plan. We know he's Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. We understand that he calls things that are not as though they are. We know in Revelation he has a white stone with a new name written on it just for me, so that when I get to heaven, he's going to give me that white stone and he's going to say, Randy, all your life, this is how I saw you. All your life, this is what I was moving you towards. All your life, every trial, every tribulation, every hard spot in the road, this is what I was doing. I was trying to get you here, son. So I am born again, born to the original plan of God. And I can look in God's word and I can see Adam, I can see Christ, I can see the word, and I can see what God intends for my life. That's the blueprint for me. That's the blueprint. Finding my place, getting into my slot, understanding who I am. I've got to understand who Jesus is. That is what God intends for me. I am being molded and shaped into his image. When I'm born again, God's taking me back to the original ideal that he had. He said, I knew you before you were shaped in your mother's womb. Before you were born, I had a mental image in my brain. And I looked at mankind and I looked at it and I said, this is what I want for mankind. This is what I want for everyone, to be like Christ. Yeah. Original creation. You got to get back, guys. If you say, what does God want for my life? Read the Word. What does God want for me? Read the Word. What kind of a man or a woman should I be? Understand who Christ is, and you'll understand who God wants you to be. Original creation. What the first Adam failed in, the second Adam was able to accomplish. Romans chapter 8, God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. The son stands first in the line of humanity he restored. We see the original and intended shape of our lives there in him. Guys, it's time for us to get in shape. It's time for us to get in shape. It's time for us to look at Christ, to look at that Adam, and to say, that's the original creation. That's what God wants for my life. That's who I need to be. We need to get back to original creation. I need to be a Christ man. That's who I'm called to be. That's what I'm called to do, to be like Christ. That's the original creation. I'm saying all this to say this to you. All this other stuff that we pick up along the way, that's not God's intention for us. All the luggage and the baggage and the stuff that we pick up along the way, get all that stuff off of you. That's not the original creation. That's not what you're born again to. You're born again to be like Christ, to get back to God's original plan. When he said in the book of Genesis, let us make mankind in our image after our likeness. Yeah. To be like him, original creation. He wants you to get back to that. The second thing I want you to see is that you've got to start living from the unseen. John chapter 3 said, the invisible moving the visible. Living from the unseen. Now listen to it. He said, whenever you get back to original creation, he said, suddenly the invisible is going to start moving the visible. The invisible is going to start moving the invisible. So instead of circumstances shaping your faith, let your faith shape your circumstances. Instead of letting your circumstances around you, the visible, shape your faith, turn it around and let the invisible man on the inside, original creation, original, Christ-like, first Adam, second Adam, original creation, what God intends for my life. I'm getting back to original plan, original ideal. I see it in the Word. This is what God wants me to do. This is who God wants me to be, original creation. I'm getting back to walk with God in the cool of the day, to be clothed by his glory, to feel no shame, walk with him, speak to him face to face, breath to breath, to have communion with him. I'm going to be a spirit man. And the invisible man is going to move the visible circumstances around me. So instead of letting my circumstances shape my faith, I'm going to make my faith shape my circumstances. We've got to quit being victims and being circumstantial. Living a life that's circumstantial. We don't shape our lives. We let lives shape us. Oh, now I've lost you. Guys, listen to me. It's time that we start living from the inside outward, that we start living from the invisible to the visible, that we start looking at situations and circumstances and we control them instead of letting them control us. It's time. Hebrews 11 said, by faith we see the world called into existence by God's word, what we see created by what we don't see. Okay? By what we don't see. Now look at 2 Samuel 23:2. Never saw this one before. God's spirit spoke through me, David said. His words took shape on my tongue. So Elohim in the beginning said, let there be light. And there was light. Okay? Are you with me? In the beginning, he created with his mouth. Now we see David saying, his words took shape on my tongue and then I released it. Now, we're not little gods. Please don't misunderstand me. But I will tell you this, that we need to learn to declare the word of the Lord. Amen. And change our circumstances and instead of letting our circumstances change us. Are you with me? We've got to shape our world with the word that we speak. He said, your word on my tongue took shape. And so we're able to look at cancer and say, I curse you, dry up and die to your and your very roots. And we're able to shape our world around us with the word. Now we're getting back to original creation. Are you with me here? In the beginning, Adam walked with God in the cool of the day. He was able to name the animals. He was able to do things that we can't even fathom because there was no sin. There was no limitations. There was no hindrance. And in John 3, he says, whenever you're born again, you're getting born again back to original creation. Well, what was the original creation? Creation, Adam. His mind, his intellect, his physical abilities, his strength. There were no limitations put on him. He was able to do things that we only dream about because he walked with God in the cool of the day. He was a man that could do things that would astound us today. He had creative ability. He was able to name those animals. The name that he gave to those animals identified their very character. This was the man. And whenever I'm born again, I'm getting back to original creation. I am telling you, there is something powerful about a man or a woman that understands this truth and they walk in the word of the Lord. They're under a spirit of prophecy. They have a word, a rhema word in their mouth. And the word of God on their lips begins to take shape, and they're able to alter things around them instead of letting their circumstances alter them. Think about that. That's powerful. Think about what Jesus did. He could say to a storm, peace be still, and the storm calmed itself. What is that? Original creation. Jesus was able to get back to original creation. He had no sin in him. He was able to get back. God looked down and said, that's my ideal for you. First Adam, you messed it up. Second Adam, he's got it going. And when he looked, that's original creation. Everything else in between are copies, mess ups. It's not what God intended. Are you with me? It's the best we could do. But when you look at Jesus, it's like, that's original creation. That's it. That's my mind. That's what's in my mind for you. Image in my mind. And so guys, listen, we've got to learn how to live from the inside out, from the invisible to the visible. We've got to learn to walk in original creation, a spirit man, born again. What does it mean to be born again? Getting back to original ideal. Getting back. We jacked it up, but Jesus came and he showed us how to do it. We're getting back to original creation where we can live from the inside out. It's time for your world to start taking shape from God's word, not the word of the enemy, not the circumstances of this world, but from God's word. What does God's word say for me? What does God's word say for my life, for my family, for my ministry? What does it say? Let the word of the Lord take shape on your tongue and then release that. When we release the word of the Lord, we're releasing that shape. It's coming out and we're saying, this is what God says. You start shifting things around you. Jesus did it. He'd walk into a room with somebody sick and dying. He rebuked the spirit of death. He would release life and he'd shift that thing. Creative power. Taking shape. Number three, I'm done. Taking shape. He said here in John 3, but the person who takes shape within, he's talking about the spiritual guy in here, the new man taking shape. The man in the mirror can blind you to the man in God's mind. When I look in the mirror, that man in the mirror can blind me to the man that's in God's mind. When I look in the mirror, I see myself with all of its stuff. But when I look at God, in his mind, there's a different image. He sees something different. He calls things that are not as though they are. Are you with me this morning? The person who takes shape within was shaped within. It's shaping up. So I look in the mirror, I can get discouraged. I look at God and I see a different image. I look in the mirror, I get discouraged. I look at God and I see a different image. He's got an image, a mental image of me. There's a revelation of me that only my Father has. And I see that. I see that. That's what I've got to focus on. Not this man in the mirror, but on the mental image that he has of me. He's in my future as Omega, Alpha and Omega, and he's calling me into my future. He's saying, come on, Randy, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, this is who you are. This is who you are. This is who you are. He's calling me towards that new name written on a white stone. Come on, come on, come on, come on. I don't always understand it because I don't know what the name is. He does, I don't yet. But he's calling me, he's calling me, he's calling me. So you see, it's time to start living from the inside out. David, come help me. From the inside out, the inside out. I got to quit allowing myself to be controlled by what I see. And I've got to start being moved by what I don't see, the unseen. The unseen in here, the original creation that's working in me, working in you. We got to do this. So you see, this morning we're talking about how powerful it is when the right person gets in the right place. But we're also talking about when you get there, make sure you got the right shape, like a puzzle piece that pops in place. You got to make sure of that. And that right shape is original creation. It's walking in the Spirit. It's being who he says that I am. Looking at Christ and being molded and shaped and conformed to the image of Christ. Understanding what the original creation is. Understanding what I'm born again to. I am born again to get back to original creation. And get rid of all this junk. All this junk. And live like Jesus did, where I can let the word of the Lord take shape in my mouth and then release it to shape my world. Word of the Lord in my mouth, taking shape, release it to shape my world. And that's hard to do. It's hard. Because when circumstances come, those circumstances start shaping my faith, saying what God can or cannot do. But suddenly I stop and I go, no, I'm gonna let my faith shape my circumstances and say, no, this is what God says. And I release his word. I want to read you one more scripture, and I'm going to get out of your way. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 says, I'm telling you once and for all that unless you return to square one and start over like children, you're not even going to get a look at the kingdom, let alone get in. For some time now, it just keeps rolling over in my spirit. Holy Spirit keeps just like whispering to me, get back to the God of your childhood. Get back to the God of your childhood. And here in Matthew, he said, unless you become a little child again, unless you get back to square one, you're not going to be able to see the kingdom. So guys, see it this way. Unless I get back to original creation, I'm born again. I get back to original creation, the innocence of that childhood, the purity of it, getting back to first love and passion, walking with God, knowing God, just your faith is high. You're so excited about the kingdom. You're so excited about the word of the Lord and you can't help yourself. You're just so in love with him. It's getting back to that first love, that first passion. Just loving the Lord and just serving God. You're getting back like an innocent child again. Born again, born back to original creation, born back to faith and hope and excitement. He says, you got to get back to square one. Back to square one. He said, if you don't, you're not going to be able to enter into the kingdom. You're not going to be able to step into a well-placed position. You're going to miss it. It takes a child. It takes a child. Listen. It takes a child. It takes a child to come into a service, raise its hands, and with tears running down their face, saying, Father, I love you, and I give you my heart and my life. I worship you. It takes a child whenever the doctor gives you a bad report, and you say, I'm gonna believe God, I'm gonna trust God. It takes that childlike faith. Are you with me this morning? Childlike. You're getting back to original creation. You're getting back. You're getting back. You're getting back to square one. So this morning, it's time. I want you to bow your heads with me. Pray with me just for a moment. Father, I sense there are many here this morning in the house, perhaps on the web, that need to come back to square one. Life has gotten way too complicated. There are too many distractions, too many. We've lost sight of what's really important. Instead of us making life happen, life just happens to us, and we just take it as it comes. We've lost our faith and our ability to shape the world around us. Our circumstances shape our faith instead of our faith shaping our circumstances. Instead of being more than a conqueror, we have a tendency to be victims. Victims. We just take it as it comes. We're not being significant anymore. We're just surviving. It's time for us to be born again. Born again. It's time for us to get back to the original creation, God's original plan for us, with all of its excitement and its passion for living, that sense of destiny that we carried as young Christians, when we were so innocent and so excited. Our faith was so high. Our love was overwhelming. First love is dizzy. Dizzy love. Intoxicating. Original, original creation. God's original plan. But somehow we lost it along the way. And it's time to be born again this morning. It's time to be born again. Every man, every woman, every young person, sinner and saint alike, it's time to be born again, to be born again, to get back to the God of our spiritual childhood, to get back to square one. You're on the move again. I sense it, Father. You're on the move again. The church must reform itself. It must reshape itself. The church has got to wake up and realize the power of place, and I've got to find my shape and get in where I fit in. But I got to get back. I got to get back to original creation. I got to get back to the original calling. I got to get back to the original passion. I got to get back. I got to get back. I got to get back to square one. We got to start over. We got to start over. So help us this morning. Help us. Help us. To get back. To get back. Help us. To the God of my childhood. When all things were possible. Let us get back. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Church, why don't you stand with me? I feel compelled by Holy Spirit to tell the church it's time to reform, to reshape yourself. It's time to find my place and understand how important it is, the power of place, and then go to my place and make sure that I slip in like a puzzle, a piece to a puzzle, and I pop in place. But you've got to get back to square one. It's got to be a square peg for a square hole. You got to get back to square one. You got to get back. I feel God saying, Randy, I'm getting ready to move again. I need my church to catch up. Catch up, catch up. I'm on the move. Catch up, catch up. It's time to catch up. Got to catch up. It's not about evil or good. This is about just people. Just people. Just people who get busy. People who get distracted. People who just lose sight of things, and we lose that first love. It's time to get back. We need some freedom in here. There are people in here that need freedom. You need some freedom. Freedom for your mind, freedom for your spirit. Just freedom. We've got too much junk going on in our churches and our lives. We've picked up stuff. We just picked it up. It's time to unload this stuff. Just check the baggage. Check it. And just get rid of it. You're carrying way too much. So this morning, I need a bigger church with a bigger altar area. Why don't you all come forward? We're going to close out corporately because I know we all feel the same way. Come on. Squeeze in tight. Squeeze up close. Squeeze up all the way to the front. If you would, I'm going to let you go. I'm not going to keep you long. I need a baby. Give me Hezekiah. Where's he at? Oh, don't go. Is there a baby in the room? Is Esther, Hezekiah? Remember in Jeremiah chapter 1, he said, before you were shaped in your mother's womb, I had an image of you in my mind. I had some thoughts about you. He has that for everybody. Because in the very beginning, he said, let us make man in our image. That word is mankind. Let us make mankind in our image. So that means every human being, God's got an ideal for them. Are you tracking? Got an ideal for them, a plan for them. And it's like when you're first born again, it's like God, he looks at you, original creation. And there's so much possibility here. There's so much potential. There's no baggage. There's no hate here. He doesn't know who he's supposed to hate and who he's not supposed to hate. There's no prejudiceness in him. There's nothing. Amen? And we look at our children and we have so many hopes and dreams for them. We have an image in our mind about our kids. But sometimes along the way, things don't always turn out the way we thought they would. But we keep hoping. And sometimes those kids come around back to the original creation. Are you tracking? So God looks at you. I got born again on August the 3rd, 1975 at 2630 South 11th Street. And he held me up that night and he said, oh, son, I've got so many plans for you. I got so many ideals for you. You're going to do such great things in the kingdom. And some of those things I've done and I'm sure some I've missed. But he's always hoping that I'll get back to original creation. Get back, Randy, get back to my perfect plan. Get back to my perfect ideal. Get back. Well, Father, what does that look like? Look in the Word. Look at Jesus. He represents my plan, my ideal. Live from the inside out, Randy. Move the visible with the invisible. Be a man of the Spirit and shape your world with my words instead of letting your world shape you. Original creation. You say, but Pastor, you don't know what I've done. Can I give you a revelation? Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to do you good and not to do you harm. Can I give you a little revelation? In that scripture tucked in there is another plan. It's a plan for the plan that you messed up. You see, God had a plan for Adam and Eve. Cain kills Abel. God says, okay, Cain's under a curse, forget that. I got a Seth coming. Seth means substitution. God's got a backup plan for the plan that you're going to mess up.
Hallelujah.
So don't lose hope. Get back to original creation. Get back to being a child. Get back to square one. Get back. And when you come to your place, you'll just slip right in like a piece to a puzzle. And when you do what you do the way you do it, you are dangerous. You're dangerous. Put your hand over your heart. Holy Spirit. I'm asking you to hover over this crowd. Hover over this crowd. As you brooded upon the waters, and there was creative power released. Brood over this congregation and release your creativity. We're getting back to original creation. We speak your word. We submit to the original creation, the wind hovering over the water creation, where the invisible moves the visible, a baptism into new life. Father, this morning, we submit to the original creation. Let your Holy Spirit hover over this congregation. That wind hovering creative power. Take us back to square one. Take us back to original creation. Take us back, Holy Spirit. Awaken things within us. Passion, excitement, faith, love. Awaken it. Let us become like little children again, where all things are possible. I'm asking you, Father, this morning, let Cathedral in the Pines be born again. Let this church be born again. Let this be a new beginning for us. Let every man, every woman, every young person in this room right now sense the power of creation. That something is stirring inside of me. Something is happening. I'm being born again. I'm getting back to original creation. I'm getting back to God's original plans for me, his original ideas. I'm getting back to that childlike faith where all things were possible. And my Father said, I've got great plans for you. Father, let us get back Let us get back to square one. Right now, Holy Spirit, you're hovering. Holy Spirit, you're hovering over this congregation and you're moving them. You're moving them. You're moving them. Creation. 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 Let us be born again. Let us reform ourselves, reshape ourselves, and get ready for what's coming, so that when it comes, we'll slip in our place and fulfill our destiny. I'm asking you, Holy Spirit, right now, do what I can't do. Holy Spirit, right now, hover, hover, and awaken original creation inside of every man and every woman. Let the original creation rise up and take his place, where we start living from the unseen, the invisible moving the visible, where the word of God is on our lips, and we shape our world with the word of God instead of letting the world shape us. I declare it this morning in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. God bless you guys. You've been so good this morning. Thank you for your patience. Turn around and greet somebody. Shake somebody's hand. Hug somebody's neck. Let them know that today is a new beginning. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you this Wednesday night.